Thank you, Allison. Thank you, Kathy. Thank you, Praise Band. Thank you. Gosh, it's great. We have our ushers and greeters back, and things are still slowly returning back to normal. So we praise God for that. If you would, turn your Bibles to Galatians 5, verses 13 through 15. But as you're turning there, let me ask you a quick question. How many of you like to play games? And, you know, games have really expanded from when I was a child, and it started even when I was a teenager. I mean, you start off with games like Aggravation and Sorry or Skip Bow, and you move on. These days, lots of people play things like Catan or Ticket to Ride. I started branching out. I did things like Diplomacy and Axis and Allies, and the Axis and Allies thing has gotten out of hand because now we've got Axis and Allies and Zombies. So, you know, there's all kinds of games you can play out there, but you know, a game probably most of us have played before and maybe enjoyed, maybe didn't enjoy. One point in time or another, we may have taken the board and thrown it across the room. But it was Monopoly, right? How many people played Monopoly? Lots of people, right? So one card was always good to have, and that was the get-out-of-jail-free card, right? It came in very handy at times. Well, what I think is a problem in the Christian faith is some people treat their Christian faith like a get-out-of-jail-free card. It's, they say, Jesus died for me, I'm forgiven, now I can do whatever I want. They treat it as a get-out-of-hell-free card. But the problem is, in truth, they probably aren't really saved. A true relationship with Jesus means the freedom we have isn't freedom to do what we want, but the freedom to love and to serve. And that's what we're going to talk about in Galatians 5, 13 through 15 this morning. For you are called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we thank you for what you have done for us through Jesus Christ. We thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, that you will help us to understand your word, that you will help me to proclaim your word, and that by being here, we'll have a better understanding about our freedom in Christ, our love for one another, and how we are to serve you and to serve each other. And it's in Jesus Christ's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. So let's start with that first verse from our passage, Galatians 5:13. For you are called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. Now, I want to note that Paul here is emphasizing freedom again. He's emphasized it throughout his letter, most recently in Galatians 5:1, where he says, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. We are free in Christ. He has given us freedom." But some apparently were taking that to mean that, you know, well, I'm free. I can live however I want to live. I can do whatever I want to do. There are no restrictions on my life anymore. Hey, Jesus Christ died on the cross. I'm forgiven. I don't have to fear death, hell, or the grave. I don't have to fear what's going to happen when I leave this life. So I can live my life any way I choose. Well, in emphasizing that freedom again, Paul realizes that he needs to give a warning for those who are misunderstanding the true nature of the gospel and the true nature of freedom and service. So he gives a warning. He says, do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. And flesh is an important word in Scripture, and it can be used multiple ways. First of all, it can refer to just to the human body, you know, the human existence. And that's why we hear that Jesus Christ took on flesh. He took on a human body. He took on human form. That has no necessarily negative or positive connotations to it. So sometimes when you come across the word flesh, it can simply mean the human body or human existence. But we're more used to it carrying a kind of negative connotation to it. And there are two ways it kind of can be negative. One is that flesh can refer to human beings as distinct from God. You know, that God is spirit, God is transcendent, God is holy, and we are not. So maybe neutral, but leaning towards the negative if human beings are distinct from God because God is so much better than we are. But then definitely sliding into the negative is the idea that the flesh is human beings in opposition to God. And this typically refers to our human nature. And most of the time when we come across the word flesh in Scripture, we think of it as a negative thing. It's referring to our sinful nature. Now, there are some out there that want to preach and teach that, well, once you become Christians, once you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, well, then you're a saint. You're no longer a sinner. But Scripture reminds us repeatedly that while we do have a new nature, and while we have been forgiven, our old nature is still inside, and we do struggle against it, that old sinful nature. That's why we don't do everything that we know we're supposed to do, because every now and then our flesh rears its ugly head and takes back control of our lives. So Paul here is saying, do not use your freedom as an opportunity for rebellion against God. Don't give in to your flesh. That isn't the point of your freedom. In fact, even though we're free, we're still servants, but our service takes on a different form. And I realize that we're trying not to be offensive, and we don't want to use certain terms in the Bible or in society sometimes, but in reality, what Paul is literally saying here is be slaves to one another. We don't want to use the term slaves. It has such negative connotations, particularly in our society. But that is literally what is being said here. Be slaves to one another. And the reminder here is that we used to be slaves to the law, but we've been set free. And we are no longer slaves to sin. We used to be slaves to sin, but we have been set free. So it's a joyous thing, this freedom, because it sets us free from the law and it sets us free from sin. And, you know, it's interesting that yesterday we just celebrated our first federal holiday of Juneteenth. It's a reminder of the abolition of slavery. And it should be something we celebrate because nobody wants to be a slave. Everyone wants to be free. In fact, if you think about it, we all have a Juneteenth celebration because when we believe in Jesus Christ as our Savior, the moment we are saved, that is our Juneteenth. That is when we are set free from our slavery to the law and slavery to sin. But there is a huge paradox in the Christian faith. And that paradox is this. We are now slaves to one another in love. In love. We haven't been set free to do whatever we want. We've been set free to live lives of love with our freedom. In fact, Martin Luther, the great reformer, said this: a Christian is perfectly free, is a perfectly free lord of all, subject to none. A Christian is a perfectly dutiful servant of all, subject to all. And you're like, well, how can that be true? Well, I think the eminent and contemporary theologian Bob Dylan probably gives us some insight into this. He wrote a song once. You have any idea what I'm going to say it is? You gotta serve somebody. Okay? You gotta. It just happens. And what God has done for us through Jesus Christ is we are set free from sin, we're set free from the law, we're given freedom, but that freedom means we can now serve the way we're supposed to. And by serving one another, we can now do what we couldn't do before. Galatians 5:14 says this, "For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." Now, Jesus taught that there were two great commandments. This is what we read in Matthew 22, verses 33 through 40. "And one of them, one of the Pharisees, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. 'Teacher, what is the great commandment in the law?' And he said to him, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and it is the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.'" So the idea here is that these are the great commandments. If you just keep them, you'll have a right relationship with God. But the problem is that no one can keep them. Might keep them some of the time, part of the time, might be able to do some of the things we're supposed to do, but we can't keep them constantly. Ecclesiastes 7:20 says, "Surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins." No one. No one is righteous. Paul picks it up in Romans 3:23 when he says, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Everyone has done wrong in God's sight. None of us have been able to live the way we're supposed to live. So what that means is we stand condemned before God. In Jeremiah 17:10, we read, "I, the Lord, search the heart and test the mind, to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his deeds." Well, what are our deeds? Our deeds are evil. Our deeds are sinful. Our deeds are unrighteousness. So we deserve to be punished for our evil deeds. And God is holy. God is perfect. God is pure. God is spirit. How can we ever measure up to God? We can't. So Jesus Christ, what he has done for us is he has fulfilled the law by dying on the cross. We couldn't keep the law. We can't keep the two greatest commandments. We are miserable failures. So what can be done? How can we be helped? Well, Jesus Christ took the punishment we deserve for our sinfulness by dying on the cross for our sins. He died in our place. This is what Jesus said about his own ministry in Matthew 5:17. "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." He fulfilled them by obeying perfectly and becoming the perfect sacrifice when he died on the cross for our sins. And this is what Paul says in Colossians 2, verses 13 and 14. "And you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross." So Jesus Christ has taken the debt that we owed God from not obeying the law, and he cleared it away. He nailed it to the cross in his flesh. He paid the price. He fulfilled the commandments so that we could be set free. Which is why Paul says this in Romans 10:4, "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes." So when we believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, what we're doing is we're acknowledging our sinfulness before God. We're acknowledging that we are not perfect. We're not holy. We don't live the way we're supposed to. We've rebelled against him. We are far from him. But we're acknowledging that sinfulness and believing in Jesus Christ and in his sacrificial death on the cross for our sins, that he died in our place, that he died so that we could be forgiven, that he died so that we could have a relationship with God, that he died so that we can have an eternity in heaven. And when we believe, we are made new. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians 5:17. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come." And this new comes through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit gives us a desire to live a new way, to live a life of love, to live a life of service, to live a life of sacrifice. We were slaves to sin, slaves to the law, but we've been set free and we've been given a new nature. And now this desire is to love, and this desire is to serve. And Jesus Christ becomes our example for how we are supposed to live. This is what we read in Philippians 2, verses 5 through 8. Have this mind yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And what this is saying to us is reminding us that Jesus Christ was in heaven. Jesus Christ was recognized as a part of the Trinity, as God. And what he did, instead of staying up there and letting all of us die in our sin, he left heaven. He came to this earth. He became a servant, a slave, and he died for us. He died so that we could be forgiven. He died so that we could have life. And the type of death is intense, horrible, agonizing, even the death on a cross. And this is the mind we're supposed to have in ourselves, a mind of self-sacrifice, a mind of service, a mind of love. A mind that fulfills the law, not from duty, not because we think it will somehow gain us our salvation, but we do it out of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. We serve one another in love. And Paul repeats this idea here from Galatians in the book of Romans, Romans 13:8. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. See, we couldn't do this before. We were selfish, we were sinful, we only had our old nature, our sinful nature, our flesh. What God has done is he's given us a new nature in the spirit. A nature that loves. God changes us so that we can live for him. Once again, it's not for salvation, not even for duty, but simply because of love and gratitude and desire. We now do what we couldn't do before through the power of the Holy Spirit, and we end up, ironically, in a sense, fulfilling the law by loving the way we're supposed to. Now, Paul goes on to give us an additional warning, a criticism. He indicates that conflict and criticism, things that are not out of love, are destructive and demonic. In Galatians 5:15, we read, but if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. And, of course, we can say that's certainly destructive, but where in the world do I get demonic? Well, it's interesting that the word here for bite generally refers to the bite of a serpent. And when we think about serpent in Scripture, we go back to the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, and we go back to the book of Revelation and what it says in relation to Satan and serpents in Revelation 12:9, and the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. So I don't think it's a coincidence that Paul uses the term bite here that refers to a serpent's bite. I think it's deliberate to remind us of the demonic and to remind us that Satan is involved when we criticize and when we engage in conflict with one another. And if we're honest, we realize that conflict has been a problem from the beginning of time, and also the beginning of the church. I mean, the beginning of time, when we look at Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel, Genesis 4:8. Cain spoke to Abel, his brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Well, there's conflict for you, right at the very beginning. There's the flesh, there's the human nature rearing its ugly head at the very beginning. But then when we come to the church, you know, right after Pentecost, and Jesus being resurrected and taken up into heaven, the Holy Spirit's been received by the disciples. We read this in Acts 6:1. Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. So once again, you have Gentile against Jew, and we have a conflict in the church. You're looking after your people more than our people. And then we read this in 1 Corinthians 1:11. Paul's writing to the church, and he says, "For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. Some are saying, I'm of Peter, and I'm of Paul, and I am of this person, and I am of that person." And you're engaging in conflict with one another. So conflict and criticism have been a part of the world and a part of the church, unfortunately. And you might wonder, why is Paul mentioning it here? Because certainly the conflict he's referring to is something that needs to be addressed. I mean, because it's about the gospel. He's saying to the Galatians, I came there and I taught you about grace. And now you're going back to works. You're saying Jesus isn't enough for salvation. You're saying that that's great, that's a start, you believe in Jesus Christ, fine, but now you've got to keep the law if you truly want to be saved and you want to be forgiven. And Paul's saying that's wrong. How can you go away from grace when you started in grace? So he in a sense, you might say, he's starting a conflict in the church. Well, he's trying to finish a conflict that has been started by the false teachers that came in. But then conflict can be good, right? Well, certainly, some forms of conflict are good, but maybe the problem that Paul sees here, and the reasons he's bringing this up the way he is not the fact that there is this conflict going on, which he's taking a part in, but the fact that it's the way that it's going on, the way they're treating one another. And I think the words of Jesus in Matthew 5:21 and 22 might give us some insight as to how, when we do engage in conflict, godly conflict over the gospel, we are supposed to behave. You have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire." Strong language. But there's a reminder that when we are engaging in conflict, we have to make sure that we're doing it in the right way and that we aren't name-calling, that we aren't just being rude and nasty, that we aren't being everything that politics has become in the United States of America, right? That's kind of tongue-in-cheek because if you know history, politics has been like this from the very beginning. It hasn't just become this way. Okay? So while Paul may be warning the church in Galatia, he's not saying that their conflict that they're engaged in right now is bad because it's about truth. But I think he might be reminding them that the way they go about this conflict and the way they react to one another is important because in Christ, we're supposed to behave a particular way to other people. And Jesus reminds us in the Gospels that conflict and criticism actually start in the heart. I mean, if we really want to treat one another properly and not bite and devour one another, then we need to make sure our hearts are right. Matthew 15:18-19. But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. And this is important because the reminder here for us as believers is that it's not enough to just treat someone nicely on the outside. you've got to watch your heart to make sure that you aren't thinking nasty things about other people, that you aren't calling them names on the inside, that you aren't being negative and critical constantly, because what eventually does happen, whether you want it to or not, is the things that start in the heart come out the mouth and come out through the actions. So it starts in the heart. And if we are concerned about conflict and criticism, what we have to make sure is that in our own hearts, we are thinking and behaving properly the way we're supposed to. And you know what? We can't do this for other people. We need to work on ourselves to make sure that we aren't the problem. Paul said this in Romans 12:18, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. He says this in Ephesians 4:31 and 32, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. We have a responsibility as Christians to watch our hearts, to guard our hearts, to make sure that we aren't being bitter and angry and critical, and that bitterness and anger and criticalness inside of us doesn't come spewing out of our mouths, and we engage in slander and we treat other people badly. We're to be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Well, how can we do that? How? If we still have this fleshly nature at times, how? How are we to be on guard against this happening? Well, I'm going to give you three keys, I think. And the first is that some of this is an act of the will. We make a decision to do what God wants. And I think we see this in Ephesians 4:22 through 24. Put off your old self. This is like taking off a garment. Put off the old self. Put off the flesh. Put off the sinful nature. Take it off. Put it to the side. Put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. There is a decision we make daily, in a sense, to take up our cross and to follow Jesus Christ. There is a decision we make moment by moment that we are not going to be bitter, angry, wrathful, critical people. We're instead going to try to be loving, tender-hearted people who serve one another, who are literally slaves to one another through love. That is the freedom we have. The old nature is that angry, hateful nature. The new nature is the forgiving, tender nature. So we make a decision, an act of the will, that we are not going to be the way we used to be. We're going to instead be the way God wants us to be. And we know how God wants us to be through His Word. And I think that's the second part of it. We choose that we're going to follow God, and then we immerse ourselves in His Word. Psalm 119 is just a wonderful exposition, an exhortation of God's Word in how it helps us. And this is just a couple of verses from it. Psalm 119, 29 through 30. Put false ways far from me and graciously teach me your law. I have chosen the way of faithfulness. Chosen the way of faithfulness. That's a choosing act of will. I set your rules before me. We immerse ourselves in the Word of God because the Word of God teaches us how we are to live. I cling to your testimonies, O Lord. Let me not be put to shame. I don't want to be that angry person anymore. I am immersing myself in your Word to help me to be forgiving, caring, loving, and to help me be a servant of all. So we start with an act of the will. We allow ourselves to be guided by the Word of God, and then we are empowered by the Spirit. And all of the rest of Galatians, but particularly next week, is going to talk about being empowered by the Spirit of God to live for Him. And that's where we're headed. So let's go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for what You have done for us through Jesus Christ. And we ask that You would help us to be like Jesus Christ, to think of others and to want to serve them, not just be selfish, not just be angry, not just be bitter, not just engage in conflict and criticism, not to have hearts that are far from You and hearts that hate others. Help us, Lord, to serve one another in love, to do what we couldn't do before because we didn't have Your nature, Your Spirit inside of us. All we had was our old nature now, before. Now we have that new nature that comes because we believe in Jesus Christ as our Savior. Your Spirit has come into our hearts and our lives. Your Spirit gives us new life. Your Spirit makes us different. Help us to be different, Lord. We turn ourselves over to You. We want to put off the old and put on the new. Help us through Your Word to know what is right, to know how we're supposed to live, and to do it because we have been empowered by Your Spirit. We've been given the desire to be different. We've been given the power to serve You. We've been given the power to serve others. Help us, Lord, to fulfill the law now, not through for salvation, not thinking because we're going to get, you know, some type of big benefit in our own lives, but primarily because it's the right thing to do, and we do it out of love, and we do it because that's the example that Jesus Christ has set before us by Him coming to this earth and dying on a cross for our sins. So, Lord, we know what we would be without Jesus. We know where we would go without Jesus. Help us, Lord, out of gratitude, out of love, to serve like we could never have served before. It's in Jesus Christ's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen.
Sometimes I sit through a sermon, Pastor Mark, and I think, oh, but that doesn't apply to me. Not the case today. Not the case today, ever, really, but definitely not the case today. And in fact, we sing this final song, which we sang earlier in the service. In your mind, at least, let's take all those third-person pronouns and turn them into first-person pronouns. I and me, Lord. Please stand and sing with us.